I've got you under my skin. I've got you deep in the heart of me, so deep in my heart that you're really a part of me. I've got you under my skin. I tried so not to give in. I said to myself, this affair never will go so well. But why should I try to resist when, baby, I know so well I've got you under my skin. I'd sacrifice anything come what might for the sake of having you near, in spite of a warning voice that comes in the night and repeats, repeats in my ear. Don't you know, little fool, you never can win. Use your mentality, wake up to reality. But each time that I do, just the thought of you makes me stop before I begin. 'Cause I've got you under my skin.
Over to you, Andrew.
Thank you very much, Keith. So, hello, and welcome to the second of our series of Reimagining the Future. And this second series is focusing on the small business and thinking small businesses first. For those of you who haven't attended the first series, the webinar program is inspired by the ideas and actions of Professor Alan Gibb, and you saw several photographs of him there. Alan was first and foremost a pioneer in the field of enterprise and small business, and he established one of the leading small business centres in the UK and in the world at the time when business schools and universities were very much focused on large companies. What's interesting is the small business centre that Alan set up emerged from a recognition that small businesses are the most significant contributors to enterprise and economic activity in pretty much all communities and economies. And from his perspective, undertaking the initial work in the northeast of England, they represented the only real, viable, long-term basis for sustainable economic growth and prosperity. And it was those paradigms of enterprise and entrepreneurship that were developed by the centre and were rooted in the experiences and context of the entrepreneurial small business. So Alan was very much a proponent in a university environment of thinking about small businesses first and understanding their worlds. And this second series does exactly that. We're starting today looking at something which we have all experienced over the last 12 to 15 months, and some countries at the moment are going through quite terrible experiences of it at present globally. But we're also looking beyond that to where we might be as we come out of coronavirus and move beyond the pandemic. And so our question very much today is, what will be the implications and impact for small businesses of that? Will the challenges of the last 12 to 15 months mean that they hunker down and become more risk averse? Or will the opening up of the economy and the very positive future economic projections create an entrepreneurial golden age where small businesses experience opportunities they might not otherwise have done? And it's difficult to know what the future will be, but we have a great panel today with us who will be able to shed light on these questions. So to start, to introduce myself quickly, my name is Andrew Atherton. I'm Global Director of Transnational Education for Navitas, a global private education provider. And my association with Alan was that I joined the Small Business Centre when he was chairman of it in the mid-1990s to set up a policy research unit, and then took over as director of the Foundation for SME Development, the successor to the Small Business Centre, in 1999 when Alan retired. So worked with him over many years. What we're going to be looking at today, as I said, is the impact of coronavirus and the implications on small businesses in the future. I'd like to now go to introduce the panel. So the panel are Professor Gordan Lauc. Gordan is founder and CEO of Genos Limited and Professor of Biochemistry and Molecular Biology at the University of Zagreb in Croatia. Caroline McKenna. Caroline is CEO and founder of Social Good Connect. Social Good Connect enables businesses and charities to collaborate and connect for good through volunteering. Monica Musonda. Monica is founder and CEO of Java Foods, a Zambian-based food processing company that provides affordable nutrition to the Southern African market. Dr. Raffaele Trapasso. Raffaele is an economist and works for the Centre for Entrepreneurship, SMEs, Regions and Cities at the OECD in Paris. And Vivian Unt. Vivian is founder and managing director of Vivian Vau Shoes, leading Estonian shoe and fashion business. So if I can start by briefly running through the format for the webinar. So the most important thing and the thing that will make this work is when you as an audience, not if, when you as an audience ask questions that are going to challenge, stimulate and encourage the panel to respond to those questions. So please, as we go forward, if you could put your questions in function and any comments around them, that'd be very much appreciated. It would also be appreciated if you could limit your use of the chat function to questions as much as possible, but of course you might have views that you want to articulate there as well. So to kick off today, we'll start by asking the panel to respond to an initial question, and then hopefully that will stimulate questions from you as an audience, and we'll then go through those questions. The format will be a Q&A session for around an hour and at around 3 o'clock UK time. So some of you will be on different time zones, but around 3 o'clock UK time, we'll break out into breakout rooms where you can meet and have more informal coffee break style chats with other members in your breakout rooms, and you'll be assigned to them. And then we'll reconvene for the last 5 minutes to talk about how we will take this this webinar forward and to thank everybody for their participation. So please start thinking now about chats, ideas in the chat function and questions in the chat function. We really do look forward to getting those questions. So to the first question for the panel. And the question I'd like to ask you as a panel is, will small businesses hunker down or will they thrive post-pandemic? And we have a very global panel, which is great. So I'm looking forward to a real diversity of views and contexts to this. If I could start by going to Monica, that'd be great. Monica, over to you.
Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you very much for inviting me to share my views. I'm an SME, actually, and you're hearing from firsthand what COVID-19 actually, how it affected my business. The question is actually really important. COVID came, nobody could have foreseen what it was going to do on the public health side, but more importantly, the impact on business. For many of us here on the continent, what was characterized by as a public health disaster then turned into an economic disaster because of lockdown and of people trying to really figure out how to contain the virus. But it had a profound effect on small business because oftentimes people could either not get to work, could not reach their customers, were not able to access raw materials to continue with their production or continue with providing a service. And it meant that they were unable to actually continue to run their businesses for several months. And this includes sectors like education, because schools were closed for 7 months, the hospitality sector, and actually really, really affected a lot of women here in Zambia. The question about, are we going to hunker down or to thrive is an important one, but also requires us to put into place certain things. I think what COVID has done is really changed the status quo. We were perhaps very comfortable in an imperfect type of business environment. And what has happened now is that we're having to rethink how we do business. we have to continue to do business, because without a doubt, Zambia, like many places in the world, is exactly the same. The small and medium enterprises actually is the bulk of many of the businesses in Zambia and on the continent. So the reality is we have to continue to thrive, but certain key things have to be put into place. Certain things have to be more accessible to SMEs to capture new opportunities, to pivot businesses, to actually perhaps do away completely with a business model which now doesn't work in a new environment. But how do we make sure that they take advantage of it? Is it giving them more access to financing at cheaper, longer term tenures? Is it giving them more technical support? Is it giving them access to partnerships and business linkages so that they continue to thrive in a new environment? These are the things we are looking to see in order to, you know, to thrive in this new, as they're calling it, a new normal. So I think, in short, I think my view is that, one, we have no choice, but we need to be smart about a new opportunity. It's been very difficult, but there are lots of opportunities which has presented themselves, but we now need to know how the SMEs can capture them. Thank you.
Great, thank you, Monica. That was really a great start. Over to you then, Gordan.
So, hello everybody. I come from a small city on the northeast of Croatia called Osijek. Nothing in particular beside one thing, and this is that Alan Gibb helped to start the PhD program in entrepreneurship in Osijek, and this was listed as one of the 20 best examples in EU a couple of years ago. So back to your question, I think this is very individual. And I think the key thing about SMEs is that they are versatile and they are flexible. So for example, my company, we are a biotech. We collaborate with researchers, we collaborate with the hospitals. And this all was really in danger when the pandemic started, because these things were shutting down. Hospitals were not accepting patients, researchers were not working. So what we did, we invested heavily in R&D. We are a R&D intensive company. We have 50 researchers. So what we did, we translated our test, which we were normally doing business to business to researchers and to companies, into a consumer product. We developed something which is now the best biomarker of biological age. We call it the glycan age. And actually pandemics helped us, because we found a new niche where people need something which they can do to improve their own health, and they can do it at home. So we started selling directly to consumers through our website. And actually, we are at the end, we are profiting from the pandemics as a company, because we are now selling globally more than ever before. So every difficulty, every challenge is actually an opportunity. And if we move in the right direction, if we are R&D intensive, we can actually survive. And I think this is the key thing for SMEs. Be small, be flexible, be inventive.
Great, thank you, Gordan, and thank you for using your business as an exemplar and a mini case study for that response. Vivian, over to you next.
Good afternoon from Tallinn, Estonia. I would like to very much carry on from Gordan's notion given that most of SMEs are passion-driven rather than serve the interests of big stakeholders, shareholders, then I think that this time has given people who are entrepreneurs the time and space to explore perhaps the facets of their passion that they hadn't before when they were in the continuous being busy all the time. And I think this will give them further fuel to thrive post-pandemic or perhaps during pandemic.
Perfect, great. Thank you, Vivian. So an interesting point around time to reflect, actually, in the quiet times of coronavirus, which is really good. And Caroline, you work with many businesses and actually nonprofits as well. I mean, it would be useful to get a sense from your engagement with them about your thoughts on this. So over to you, Caroline.
Thanks, Andrew, and great to be here. Well, I think it's a phenomenal opportunity for businesses to thrive. We actually launched our business the first day of lockdown. Can you believe it? Who thought that was going to be a great idea? And we've been through so many ups and downs, roller coasters, and we also work with hundreds of SMEs. I can see in the chat someone's asking about micros, including micros. And, you know, I think there's so many organizations have been able to flex and adapt their services really, really quickly. So those that never use digital were pondering it, maybe next year, maybe in a few months, we'll get around to it. We're forced into it. And I think now that they've been able to sell online, that they can really see that opportunity. They've, you know, we've got over the fear of that. And we can really see the opportunity to take that further. I was reading an article that yesterday about some stats that 76% of SMEs introduced new services during the pandemic. 50% have said that that service was critical for their survival. And 88% said it was a brilliant idea and they're going to plan to keep on using, you know, having that service post-COVID. So, you know, that ability and, you know, following on from the rest of the panel's comments to flex and adapt. And of course, the pandemic's driven innovation in areas that we really didn't think about before. So creativity and competitiveness, you know, think about how we hire staff. So my whole team and many others have recruited all via Zoom, all online, people all around the world, not just local to your office and where your office is based or where your business is based. That's a really exciting opportunity for many people. And I think for us, it's really been about, you know, leadership. The leaders who put people in purpose at the core and at the heart of everything that they do will win. People are our greatest asset. We can't, you know, that's just it. There's no greater asset. And the ones that I've seen that have come out of this really strong are those who are really resilient. We talk about resilience as a new strength of leadership now, but it's absolutely number one up there. But it means that businesses are better placed to respond quicker to new opportunities that have been brought about by the pandemic. And we obviously work with businesses to promote volunteering as a way of supporting companies' mental health and so on. And we've seen such a surge in people asking for that. It really is about people's mental health and well-being and businesses who, you know, we saw this amazing neighborhood community spirit that came through COVID, and we want to keep that going really. And so we've seen lots of businesses saying, we want to do more, we want to be better in that space. Can you help? So yeah, just some of my thoughts, Andrew.
That's great, thanks, Karen. I've got to ask you a question. When you started on the day that coronavirus went public, if you like, was it before or after you needed it gone public? Was there...
we knew, and there was lots of gin involved. Let's put it that way, Andrew.
I can imagine. Thank you, Carol. Raffaele, I mean, you obviously work in the OECD and have a strong, you know, perspective across many different contexts and environments. Your views on this question around hunkering down or thriving post-pandemic?
Thank you, Andrew. It's a great pleasure to be with you today in this discussion. And you know, I'm in the Center for Entrepreneurship and SMEs, and then cities and regions. And so I should have a very good answer to your question, but in reality, I don't know. I don't know because there are several things that are difficult to understand at the moment. First, let's start about defining SMEs. You know, it's defining SMEs is like looking at the stars in the summer sky. You have planets, stars, but you have also materials, something small, something less resilient. Now, just to say that we are dealing with a very complex universe of actors. And then I think that this immense generational change that is COVID will necessarily need to rethink also the way in which you ask your question. In a sense, will SMEs survive? Well, many will not, but can we accept that? in the sense that I think that policy has to change a little bit, because from the Darwinism of the survival of the fittest, we need to accept the fact that there are a lot of businesses, you know, a part of those that are with us today, but there are a lot of businesses that will struggle a lot. And then we as a society have to ask if it's right that they are wiped out of the crisis, or if there are policies that should be put in place to help them survive, whether the crisis rebuild and come back in a better shape in the market. I think that this is something that might be aligned with Alan Gibbs' vision of this, you know, overcoming the remediable lapses of economic actors to generate, you know, something that might be a corporate welfare that gives entrepreneurs and SMEs the possibility to regenerate themselves and move towards a new phase of the economy in which new value have emerged, like sustainability, inclusion, probably new narratives will influence the policies that will follow the pandemic.
Great, thank you, Raffaele, and thank you to all the panelists for that response to that initial question. We're getting a lot of interesting questions and comments in the chat function. I'll try and pull some of them together, but one of the themes that really seems to be coming out is this might not have been a uniform experience because there's a real diversity of different SMEs, and even if some businesses, some smaller businesses have pivoted, it isn't necessarily always easy. So I think there are questions around, does it include micro enterprises? What's the cost of pivoting? So maybe we could take those together and ask the panel, or ask some members of the panel their views about how easy has it been to pivot? What are the challenges? Even if it ends up all good, what have you had to go through to get to that? And I'll maybe focus initially on the three entrepreneurs on the panel. So Vivian, what's it been like for you over the last 12 to 15 months? Has it been tough? Has it been easy? Have you ended up in a good place? And what's the experience been?
For me, the experience, I'm very grateful for the experience. And I took this, I took a lot of strength from the yogic wisdom that the only way out is in. And I invested time into understanding the components of the immune system, that is not just the physical health, but the mental health, the good, how nervous system and the immune system are interconnected, how important the good state of my microbiome is, and so on. And because I knew that if I go down into depression, then that is the end of it for my company, or rather maybe it wouldn't be the end, but the energy invested into staying mentally afloat pays off much better than first going down and then having to pull myself up. So I was very consciously looking after my own immune system, my own level of joy, and I was a winter swimmer before, but then I continued the discipline, even though I didn't have any, you know, appointments to go to, but I felt that it was very important. And also I realized that with whatever the outer conditions are or the circumstances, if you see yourself as a victim of them, then you give your power away. And if you take the stance of trying to see what could it be good for, what is it here to teach me, then with that curiosity, the curiosity itself keeps you from going down with the spiral. And so for me, it has been a wonderful year of personal growth, that I can say. Of course, business-wise, I can't boast with great figures, but I think I will be from after this year, I will be a lot more strong, a lot more creative. And I have also had the opportunity to look into my own limiting beliefs, for example, about online shoe shopping. I didn't believe in it before because I felt that shoes have to be tried on, and coming into the shop is part of the experience. This year has given me the opportunity to understand why I was resistant, to overcome the resistance within, and now the online shop that I am creating will be so much better than if I would have actually done it before, because of my clients asking me to do it. Now it's coming from within, and it's the outcome, I am sure, will be so much better.
Great, thank you, Vivian. And Gordan, over to you.
Yes, so I can just continue on that. So Vivian, you did a great job by using the problem to kind of improve yourself. And I think this pandemic will help many people understand that we are responsible for our own health. It's not the government. We don't expect from the state to protect us from disease. We have to think about staying healthy. And this is what we do. Our business is helping people to stay healthy by giving them an insight into what they cannot see in a mirror, because the mirror just gives an image, while the body is a molecular complex organism which you can measure. So for us, pandemics was really an opportunity to develop a product which people need. And I think that's one of the big advantages of SMEs, is that we can see what people need. Vivian, you saw that people want to buy shoes. They cannot go to the shop. You open the web shop. We see people thinking more about their health. We develop a test which can give them feedback to see whether what they're trying works or not. So I'm a big believer in small business. Of course, in a matter of crisis, we also need help. And for example, the Croatian government was very supportive. All the companies which were losing significant amount of income got support. They helped us keep people on a payroll, at least for a little bit more than a minimal wage, but at least the state was helping, because small companies are important. They are they're creating the majority, actually, of things which are being created, but they're also very sensitive. You know, we are all, for example, my company, we are always over-investing in research. And we don't have a big pile of money which can keep us alive if there is a problem. So yes, we need support, we need help, we need to work together with the big companies, but I always think the crisis is an opportunity.
Thank you, Gordon, that's great. And we might come back to that pivot question in a little while. Monica, same question to you. How's it been, and what have you learned?
Yeah, no, and it's a great question, because it's easier said than done. I can tell you the first reaction for us was how to survive, and survive really understanding what was the impact going to be on COVID, because one, nobody really knew how long we were going to be in this situation. And so nobody knew, for instance, how much runway we really needed, how we were going to continue to pay staff, whether or not we needed to go and renegotiate contracts, which we had with some of our suppliers, as well as some of our customers, to say that we're going to delay on delivery, or we might not deliver at all. So I think the first sort of reaction was, you know, can we survive in our current form? And then very quickly, we realized that actually the impact was going to be much more, much longer, and we might not know how it was going to end. And that is when we began to see what else could we do at the moment. And the thought process is not always automatic. I think I've got to say it depends on whether you're a much larger SME with a much stronger workforce or where you can actually think through your strategy and say, okay, this is what we do, but can we provide it differently to the customer who is now either sitting at home, is unable to come and see us, or unable to come in to purchase? How else can we get paid for services and products that we have? So speaking for Java here in Zambia, we're a food processing business and we were considered essential, but we had a number of things we had to think about. How are we actually going to distribute our products safely to our customers and ensure that we're going to get paid? So we had all these all different sort of issues. And even on products, we realized our major brand is an instant noodle brand, which does very well when schools are open, but schools were closed for 6 months. So we needed to really think very quickly about, you know, we're in a health crisis. How can we now sort of promote healthy eating? And then we partnered very much. We looked out for partnerships with NGOs who were doing emergency relief. It was something which was something we didn't do regularly. I mean, we did do some emergency relief work, but not as a priority. And very quickly, we realized that we needed to find additional revenue to continue to keep the lights on. We had no choice but to think differently and to take advantage of an opportunity. But it really needs to be said that SMEs need the support to see and take advantage of the opportunities. In Africa, and particularly where we're from in Zambia, we were not as fortunate as many other countries where the government was very quick to support salary payments or to support SMEs to pay simple things like rent. And we did lose a lot of SMEs, but we are now seeing the SMEs rethinking, coming back, actually even closing down businesses and starting up new businesses in order to take advantages of some of the opportunities. And like I said in the beginning, we have to create an environment which allows for an open discussion with government, with key stakeholders, key industry players, in order for us to reignite our economies, reignite our business environment. It's not easy where everything is fragmented, or where I come from, where we have a lot of very big multinationals who sit on a lot of money and sometimes then take over the crisis. But you really have to be very intentional about how to support SMEs with technology, with financing at the right cost and tenure, with also technical support as well. So totally agree that it's easier said than done, but it's not impossible.
Great, thank you, Monica. And can we maybe come on to a couple of questions in the chat function? So if I could bring together Lucy Cairo's question and Yolanda Gibbs' comment on it. So Lucy's question is, what is the cost on SMEs to pivot? I think all three of you as entrepreneurs have talked about pivoting. So what's the cost on SMEs to pivot real time in order to survive? And Yolanda's comment, which I think is very complimentary, is although many businesses have positive stories, there are many businesses around Yolanda in Spain which have found it very difficult to stay afloat, but have survived until now. Some of them thanks to relatively easy, or maybe not, accessible finance, but they're now very fragile and will not be able to pivoting again. So maybe something to think about. And Caroline, given the businesses you've been working with and some of the comments you've made, I mean, it would be really useful to get your sense about the cost and the challenge of pivoting, as well as the positive outcomes and the views from the businesses that you're talking to. If you could give us your thoughts on that, Caroline.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Yolanda's absolutely right. It's really, you know, we've heard some heartbreaking stories of businesses almost overnight, having to close down, and, you know, businesses that have been phenomenally successful over the last, you know, few years. And I think those businesses that were in a real growth sector, you know, albeit they've been able to survive, a bit like, you know, Vivian's described, but they've been able to survive, but they're basically going back to where they were pre-pandemic, so it's not going to be as quick. But it's the ones who really haven't been able to access funding. You know, I've been on webinars with 15 businesses who've been around a long time, and you know, 60% of them were chatting about how their business has just gone boom during the pandemic because they happened to sell a product that everyone absolutely loved, and their growth's been huge. And on that same call, you know, there's hotel owners saying, overnight we have no one coming to stay, And so there's a huge cost to it. There's a huge cost to the economy. SMEs are absolutely critical to the recovery part of post-COVID. And I think, you know, the bounce back loans and things that have been offered in the UK and other countries, whilst hugely supportive at the time, people now start to need to start paying them back from June. There's a huge cost to that, you know, and there's some terms around that, but there's still a massive cost to it. It wasn't free money. So, you know, all those things need factored in. And I think the point about that challenge, and it's when I talk about resilience, is it's that capacity to recover from difficult situations. And, you know, this has really tested everyone to the limit in terms of, you know, everything, every business skill. And I think, Andrew, we touched on it when we first spoke about the fact that businesses are working 10 times, business owners are working 10 times longer hours than they've ever worked before, and doing everything. I mean, they always have to juggle, don't they? But, you know, so I think, yeah, I think there's huge costs to it, and some will be very fragile. Some won't be able to pivot again. But I do believe that there will absolutely be a place for offline businesses to not just survive but thrive.
That's Caroline. And Raffaele, from your perspective, the cost of pivoting and the fragility that small businesses have been facing, your views on that?
Thank you, Andrew. This reality connects to the discussion that I was making before, in the sense that we were relatively lucky that the COVID-19 pandemic hit after the 2008 crisis for two main reasons. The first one is that policymakers were convinced about the need of intervening. And the second is that the financial sector was loaded with capital, with funds. So There is this double edge that is an advantage, and these are the conditions that allowed many countries in the world to generate an immense support for SMEs, and this was acceptable from a societal and an economic point of view. Although there are voices now that are raising up against the negative interest rates, and so against this status quo in policy. For this reason, it is important that the support is quickly transformed into policy to change and improve. Because those, and I go back to what I was saying before, is not about surviving now. It's not about resilience. Resilience is the past. Now there is the rebuilding. And the rebuilding part could be a way in which there is a new contract between governments and SMEs about the need to improve entrepreneurship capabilities. So more entrepreneurship management. Think about high performance work practices in SMEs or something like that. There is need for innovation. Because you know, the way in which SMEs absorb innovation is not anymore through machinery like it was in the 70s, is much more complex. And then there is a need to discuss about skills. In many countries, there are the beginning of the new century, there are these sectoral funds, interprofessional funds, but training schemes and always to favor large organization more than SMEs. I mean, doing training in SMEs is still difficult because of the lack of time, because if you take a person from a small enterprise for a long time, it is difficult for the enterprise, the SME to go on and function. So I think that this is something that SMEs themselves, their organization, people like you, Andrew, in small business centers have to work with. So what takes to transform support into a policy that changes and improves the performance, the capacity, the capabilities of SMEs and self-employed. And then this, of course, will require a new fiscal pact for everyone, in the sense that, you know, there was this discussion about business, small business thriving. Well, a business that really made money during the pandemic is Amazon. So, and this is much more than many SMEs, but the fiscal impact in Europe of Amazon does not necessarily reflect the revenues that they did. So, I mean, there is a need to understand how to rebalance fiscally the economy to go and find those resources that can make sustainable this idea that we have to support SMEs because they represent a feature, no, not a problem, a feature of many economies, and this is where we need to intervene the most to promote the innovation, skills, good management practices, and entrepreneurship. Thank you. Sorry for being so long.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you, Raffaele. I mean, that's really helpful. Can I move on now to some of the comments and questions that have been asked in the chat function around resilience, and maybe bring resilience and leadership and health, and maybe we can look at that in terms of personal resilience and leadership and health, as well as organizational resilience and health. I think people have discussed that, and you know, what has been the impact, and is resilience a good thing or a bad thing? Is it a double-edged sword, and what have the impacts been? So maybe if we could go to Monica to give your views on that, that'd be great.
And this is actually a really important question, because I think in the beginning, the aspect of mental health, resilience, was not really addressed. I think, again, we didn't know how long we were going to be in a pandemic mode, and didn't really fully understand the impacts in the beginning. And as time went on, I think the aspect of health, mental health, and really the status of the people who we work with became really important, that in order we began to talk about and discuss how we were going to fund safe working environments. And it still is a very important point that we discussed today. For us who are in processing or manufacturing, it is now one of our number one priorities. We used to talk about occupational health very differently from the way we talk about it now. So it is it's a discussion we have. It's not only about being safe in the workplace, but mentally, are we talking to people who have had to work from home, continuously work from home? Are we creating an inducive environment for them to be productive and efficient in their home environments? And in Africa, where things around infrastructure remain a key issue for us, are you able to access internet at a good cost? Is it stable and consistent in order for you to perform? Do you live in an environment where you can do the work? All these are issues which many SMEs face, and even to, as we've been talking about pivoting, I was thinking about, you know, in the education sector, a number of schools who then now began to offer online courses. But it was very difficult if you live in an environment where there are many of you and perhaps you only have power for 6 hours of the day. These are very everyday issues for us here on the continent. But I think we need to consult and discuss more about the mental aspects of and how it has changed the way we're doing things. Now for us, we are much more flexible. So if someone needs to go home, they're not feeling well, we have policies around how we can promote good health. It's not just about feeling well, but it's also mental health now, how we discuss these issues and not discriminate against someone who's going through a very hard time with the changes. So I think that was my contribution to that. Yeah.
Great, thanks, Monica. And if we go to Gordan next, and then after that's Caroline. Gordan.
That's a tough question, because, well, I'm a biologist. I look things in a little bit different way. And usually what happens that in a crisis, people kind of burned out inside, because we all are facing challenges. So our companies are under threats. It's difficult to pay salaries. Maybe we have to fire people. And that's not easy to cope with. So, okay, I'm looking from my perspective, and this is a small business owner. And in this situation, it's relatively easy to forget about yourself and your health. And then eventually, when things improve, people just collapse. And this is something we see always after the war. So people start dying after the war, not during the war. Because when we are under stress, we have our biological mechanisms which help us fight, but they are consuming huge amount of energy. And then when the stress is taken away and we relax, so many people virtually just drop dead, get a heart attack, stroke, and go on. So I think we have to think about the psychological health of everybody, because I think pandemics are doing huge damage, because so many people are not, they cannot cope of staying isolated, they need a social support, and big part of the Western world just put everybody in a jail, home detention, but it's virtually a jail. So it's a very complicated issue. And then on top of that, you put this challenges about survival of your company, income for your family. We need support for that. And this is not easy, because you know there's no way a system for psychological support built for the pre-pandemic time can cope with a situation where every second person needs help. So this is something which has to be dealt with somehow globally, with kind of media messages. You know, guys, everything will be okay. It's not so bad. Don't panic about the next variant. Don't panic about the new strains. We are not all going to die because of these pandemics. We have to build optimism in people and somehow try to survive psychologically, all of us.
Thank you, Gordon. That was really good. And Caroline, your views and experiences?
Thanks, Andrew. Well, yeah, you know, Monica and Gordon, it's really great to hear about those experiences. I'm really passionate about this topic. And, you know, if resilience is about the process of adapting well in the face of adversity, it's not a trait. It involves behaviours, thoughts and actions that can be learned and developed. You know, human beings are naturally resilient, but business owners have had to face difficulties and challenges in the past. I think it just came like a slam dunk, you know, and it was having all those things together that's been the tough part. But being resilient, so if you say, wow, you know, someone will say to me, you're just so resilient. It doesn't mean that I don't go through stress, that I don't go through real challenges, real difficulties, cash flow, staff, looking after the people. You know, those are real things that affect me as a business owner every single day. And, you know, I think considering how we respond to those pressures and those stresses is really important. It's really critical. So, you know, things like, you know, we went through those periods where we had wild dreams, didn't we, in the first lockdown, and everyone was saying, why have I got all these crazy dreams? And, you know, it's a form of trauma, what's happened, really. And then we were all crazily online and people were getting headaches, and now we've got blue glasses that stop us getting, you know, there's all this amazing things happening and coming out. You know, I saw really colleagues who were, they were piling on so much pressure. They were at breaking point. They were really stressed. And it's how we get back to that, as Gordon describes. And I think, you know, how do you rest? How do you replenish? What do you do as a business? How do you know when enough's enough? How do you know that actually putting on your own oxygen mask first before helping others is actually the most important trait for a business leader who can support their people? And, you know, I think there's an analogy for humans need to replenish, which is trees have seasons, leaves die, but they're replenished ready for the next season. And we've got cycles too, right? We go up, we go down, we go across, we zigzag. And I think there's some factors about resilience, self-awareness, knowing who I am and what my strengths and challenges are and my trigger points, detecting and managing any changes in my physical, mental and emotional issues, being able to see the reality and not, as Gordon describes, what the media are telling us, and accept where we are. I think the capacity to make realistic plans. I know SMEs who created daily cash flow forecasts and they changed daily and the plans never came to fruition, but the ability to create those plans and take control of the areas that you felt in control of, and having an overall sense of purpose and meaning in your life, you know, and self-care. I think those are really the most important factors. And Gordon just reminded me about a quote that Viktor Frankl said about between stimulus and response, there is space. And in that space is our power to choose our response. And in our response lies our growth and our freedom, back to the learning that Vivian talked about as well. So yeah, really important topic.
Great, thanks Caroline, Gordon. And actually, Ron, moving on to the next question, can we maybe bring both Vivian and Raffaele into this as well, and your views about what the other panelists are saying and about the question as well? I mean, Vivian, your views to start, and then Raffaele.
I absolutely so agree with what Gordon and Caroline were saying, and during the past year, I have given a lot of thought about what Viktor Frankl wrote, and I think it is so important to really look within and realize that your power lies within, rather than rely on the government to look after your immune system or happiness, because you are the only person who can really do it. And to assume responsibility, I think it is so important. And like Caroline mentioned, self-awareness and sense of purpose that give you the power to carry on, really. Because this, it is one of the many fuels, but when you do feel that when what you do is driven by a passion, either to serve or to help other people, for example, then this, you are tapping into an endless resource. You are not, in that sense, I think when you are tapping into your passion, then it's, you are creating from the infinite rather than finite. And this whole year has been a marvelous opportunity to, I think, to look within and to reflect and to, well, first of all, start understanding yourself better, and understand your strengths and where your strengths lie, and to really connect with your inner strength, because it is very easy to be happy when the sun is shining. But in Estonia, in the month of January, we had 14 hours of sunshine. So you have to be connected with your inner sunshine. And weather is a great example, because it's universal, except for, of course, in Africa, it's a lot sunnier than in Estonia on average. But I'm sure you know what I mean, that it is the necessity to go within and search for the answers within. I think people have become more aware of it over the past year. And the more people take responsibility for their own happiness and for their own health, both mental and physical, I think the greater the global outcome.
Thank you, Vivian. And Raffaele?
No, I think this discussion about resilience is multidimensional in the sense that resilience is not necessarily a good characteristic or a positive one. And this is there are some negative concepts related to resilience. And we have to understand how to transform this discussion about resilience in something positive that can be used from the side, the perspective of policy to generate that corporate welfare that I had mentioned before, reducing free riding, reducing inefficiencies, et cetera. So a new contract between SMEs and policymakers. And then there is also this point, and this is the other discussion, the other dimension of resilience that is has a very strong spatial dimension in the sense that there is inevitably this COVID, the post-COVID pandemic will bring about a reorganization of production and business in space, and inevitably businesses, small businesses that are in more peripheral areas or areas that suffered from long term decline will disappear, generating an agglomeration of SMEs, businesses in some central places. On the one hand, there is, of course, we will see what it will be, teleworking, how many jobs will be amenable to teleworking in the future. But, what I want to say that is there are many different narratives that can be associated with resilience, and we have to understand what is better to for us with the objective to create a policy framework that supports, promotes, and generate SMEs that are sustainable, inclusive, and economically efficient.
Great, thank you very much. So we've got a few minutes. I'm going to ask each of the panelists to wrap up just with one observation from the last 50 minutes or so of discussions and questions around this hunkering down or thriving in the future question. So just one key observation, one takeaway, please, from each of you. Monica, can I start with you, please?
Hello, there we are. Yes, you can indeed. I think one key takeaway, and something we haven't really done very well here, is around the policy issue. I think we have had a lot of discussion, and I've been a part of a lot of discussions here about how to manage in this new COVID environment. But how is this translating into policy and continuity? Because we now need to actually accept that this is COVID has changed our lives and the way in which we do business, and we now need to create a new set of rules, if I can say that, and how we conduct ourselves. And I do like the discussion around actually creating policies which will enable much more resilient SMEs, able to handle shocks better risk assessment, and more support, which allows for more support for SMEs. Also, I would love to see much more, a second point, love to see much more thinking around how to finance SMEs in a crisis, how we can get funding to them quickly with as they need it, in a form in which they are able to pay back, or if it's grant funding. Yeah. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Gordan, your one key takeaway.
So something we were not mentioning, and this is that actually pandemics is coming to its end. So I think we should start thinking about the post-pandemic time and what things did we learn and what can we do better in the future? And in particular, what can we do to prepare better for the next pandemics to avoid this 18th century approach to contain it?
Great, thank you, Gordon. And Vivian, your one key takeaway?
Gosh, I love you. 18th century approach is very appropriate. My key takeaway is I really like what Caroline was saying about neighborhood spirit, that this I think it is very important that we continue to nurture it.
Great. Good. Thank you. That was really nice and succinct. And Caroline.
Vivian stole mine. No, I just think, that we've got often, I said it at the start, but we've got this great opportunity. And the support networks that are out there for SMEs need to also adapt and innovate so that we are seeing lots more businesses start up. There's some great stats around how many new businesses have started up during the pandemic. How many people have made a life decision to move on from a long career in a bigger company to set up themselves. And I think that, some great conversations today and for the future, as Gordan described, it is about thinking about the future, what's next. And I think there's lots of support organisations, not just government, but other SME organisations that really need to teach SMEs and support them with the right money, really, to allow them to not just survive but thrive.
Thanks, Caroline, and that's reinforcing Vivian's message. And Raffaele.
Thank you, Andrew, because I really liked today's discussion, but I cannot refrain to think about the recovery plans I have been reading over the past weeks. And in some of those, SMEs are still treated like a problem. Is the discussion, our economy is dominated by SMEs. It is a problem because we are not innovative, we are not sustainable, we are small, etc. So I think that it is good to see that there are some corners in the global discussion in which we all recognize that, on the contrary, SMEs are powerful engine of sustainable, inclusive economic growth. But this must become more evident, more clear. And I think that we have to scratch our heads to understand how better assess, probably, or communicate or work to prove that SMEs is not a challenge, is just a feature of many, or most actually, economies. And that is worth, as I said, to provide better definitions, to better understand the phenomenon, to create better intermediate institutions that can organize the voice of SMEs, and to generate a new idea of policy that has sustainability, resilience, inclusiveness, et cetera, et cetera. So what is the new SMEs policy in the recovery moment to build back better? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Raffaele. And can I just say thank you to all of our panelists? I thought that was a very stimulating discussion, shifting from the personal social through the psychosocial through to business models and pivoting. So a real range. You'll have an opportunity to spend a bit more time with our panelists. We're now going to break into informal coffee break style groups, and then a few minutes before the end of the session, we'll reconvene briefly. So if you hold tight and stay patient, we'll just sign you through to your groups. But in the meantime, thanks again to the panelists for a really stimulating and wide-ranging and insightful set of comments and responses. Thank you. Great, good. So we're pretty much at time. So I'd just like to say thank you again to our panelists. There are a few other people to thank. Keith, who quietly and calmly is the personification of the swan, gliding smoothly through the water and doing a lot of work below the surface, but also Dinah Bennett, Mary Evans, Gay Haskins, Susan Frankis, as a lot of people have given a lot of time these time without payment to make these webinars. So thank you. And I'd just like to close by announcing the next webinar, which again, this webinar series is about the small business and think small first. And the next one on June the 18th is around business startup and new venture creation, and looking at dynamic both during coronavirus, where we've seen a significant increase in business startups in many countries and beyond. So we thank you very much for all the questions and comments as an audience. Thank you to the panelists. Thank you to the organizing team. And we look forward to seeing you both on the 18th of June and hopefully for the workshops on growth on the 3rd of September and new business models for the 21st century. Depending on your time zone, have a good Friday afternoon or morning, or if you're already into the evening, have a great weekend. Thanks all very much.